Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome to Ummah Radio. You are listening to the Tafseer class with myself, Abu Musab. Now, as you know, we are doing the kitab known as Tafseer al-Qur'an al-Azim of Imam Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, which is better known as Tafseer Ibn Kathir, and this is the abridged, the mukhtasar version of that kitab. Now, if you don't have the kitab, you can download it from Ummah Forum, which is www.ummah.com/forum. In the Ummah Radio subsection, you will see a sticky thread called Saturday Tafseer Class, and in there you will find a download link to this 3 volumes of this kitab. So we are still busy with volume number 1 in Surah Al-Baqarah, and we had in our previous class just completed ayah number 33 of this particular surah. So tonight, inshallah, we begin, or rather we continue onwards from ayah number 34, which in this particular print of the book will begin on the very last line of page 32, which is ayah number 34. So to begin, بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. So in this particular chapter where we are busy dealing with here in Surah Al-Baqarah, we are dealing with the chapter with Adam عليه السلام, the Malaika and Iblis, and this whole incident which unfolded in Jannah before the creation of Adam alayhi salam, and now this is after Adam alayhi salam was created, and this is where this ayah now comes in. And Allah now addressed the malaika, and Allah said, Allah relaying the story to us, where Allah said, وَإِذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمَ فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ أَبَى وَاسْتَكْبَرَ وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ. Allah says, وَإِذْ قُلْنَا, and mention, O Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the Muslims, إِذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا, when we told the malaika, اسْجُدُوا لِآدَم, prostrate, make sajda to Adam alayhi salam, فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيس, so all of the malaika, they prostrated, they made sajda to Adam alayhi salam, إِلَّا إِبْلِيس, except for Iblis, أَبَى, he refused, وَاسْتَكْبَرَ, and he was arrogant, he thought himself to be proud and great and mighty, and all his haughtiness. وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ, and he was one of the kuffar, the disbelievers in Allah, as a result of this action of his. Now we move on to a bit of the tafsir regarding this ayah. Imam Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, he says, وهذه كرامة عظيمة من الله تعالى لآدم, that this is a great virtue, a great honor which Allah, من الله تعالى لآدم, امتن بها على ذريته, it is a great honor which Allah has bestowed upon Adam عليه السلام, or rather a great honor for Adam عليه السلام which Allah has bestowed upon his offspring, that حيث أخبر أنه تعالى أمر أمر الملائكة بالسجود لآدم, where Allah had informed that He had commanded, informed us now, that Allah had commanded the ملائكة to make sajda to Adam عليه السلام. He says, وقد دل على ذلك أحاديث أيضا كثيرة منها, منها حديث الشفاعة المتقدم. He says that there are numerous ahadith which are mentioning that very same thing, meaning that Adam alayhi, that the malaika had made sajda to Adam alayhi salam. It's not something which is only mentioned in this one particular ayah alone, but there are numerous authentic ahadith which speaks about the incident that the malaika had all made sajda to Adam alayhi salam. So he says, and one hadith from those many ones is the hadith of Shafa'a, which we had passed by previously, which is the famous hadith where on the day of Qiyamah, the people will come to Adam alayhi salam and they will say, O Adam alayhi salam, you are the father of mankind, and Allah had let the malaika prostrate to you and everything of the sort. And Adam alayhi salam would say, I cannot help you, go to someone else, nafsi, nafsi. And then the people will go to Musa alayhi salam and Isa alayhi salam right through until they finally come to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi salam. That hadith is known as Hadith al-Shafa'ah, and we have passed by that hadith in an abridged format. But in any case, you say that hadith is one of those just that explicitly mentions that the malaika had made sajda to Adam alayhi salam. So he says, Mina hadith al-shafa'at al-mutaqaddim, the previous hadith of shafa'ah, that is one of them. Furthermore, he says, wa hadith Musa alayhi salam, and the hadith of Musa alayhi salam, and this is another hadith also on the same topic, that wherein Musa alayhi salam had spoken to Allah and said, Rabbi arini Adam, O Allah, show me Adam alayhi salam, alladhi akhrajana wa nafsahu min al-jannah. That Adam alayhi salam who had himself and all of us removed from Jannah. Falamma ijtama'a, then when Allah had made the meeting between Adam alayhi salam and Musa alayhi salam, falamma ijtama'a bihi qala, anta Adamu alladhi khalaqahu Allahu biyadihi wa nafakha fihi min ruhihi wa asjada lahu malaikata. That anta Adamu alladhi khalaqahu Allah, that you are the Adam, the one who Allah had created biyadihi, with his hand, wa nafakha fihi min ruhihi, and he blew his soul into you, wa asjada lahu malaikatahu, and he caused his malaika to make sajda to you. So the reason why he's quoting this hadith here is just to show that in this hadith and in the previous hadith and in many others as well, it's explicitly mentioned that the malaika made all sajda to Adam alayhi salam. He says, qala, وذكر الحديث كما سيأتي إن شاء الله. And he says that the hadith, this one here, this lengthy hadith between the conversation between Musa alayhi salam and Adam alayhi salam, it will still come in future, inshallah. He's just bringing it just for this one short point of a year, and he's not actually planning on discussing it right now. So that's something that we'll have to wait until then. Any case, that was all the reason why he brought that there. Now we move on further. He says, وَالْغَرَضُ أَنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى لَمَّا أَمَرَ الْمَلَائِكَةَ بِالسُّجُودِ لِآدَمَ دَخَلَ إِبْلِيسُ فِي خِطَابِهِمْ. He says that the whole point and the crux of the matter is that when Allah Ta'ala had commanded the Malaika to make sajda to Adam alayhi salam, then دَخَلَ إِبْلِيسُ فِي خِطَابِهِمْ. Iblis was also included in that address, that when Allah gave this address that all of you make sajda, he was included, despite the fact that he was not from the malaika, he was not an angel. لأنه وإن لم يكن من عنصرهم إلا أنه كان قد تشبه بهم وتوسم بأفعالهم. He says, لأنه, because of Iblis, وإن لم يكن من عنصرهم, despite the fact that he was not from their race, he was not from their type, he was not an angel, he was a jinn. إلا أنه كان قد تشبه بهم, but he had come to resemble them, not as in looking like an angel, but تشبه بهم وتوسم بأفعالهم, he was following in the footsteps of the malaika, that how they worshipped Allah, he was also worshipping Allah, he was following their good deeds and stuff. فلهذا دخل في الخطاب لهم وذم في مخالفة الأمر. He says, for this reason, he was included in the address as well to the malaika to make sajda, despite the fact that he was not a malak. But, and also, وَذُمَّ فِي مُخَالَفَةِ الْأَمْرِ, and he was rebuked and censured, he was the one, فِي مُخَالَفَةِ الْأَمْرِ, مُخَالَفَةِ الْأَمْرِ, the one who, as we mentioned in the previous class, that the malaika had not put up any objection to Allah, but it was Iblis who had done this evil action. So he was the one who did wrong, he was the one who had concealed the hatred and things in his heart, and the malaika had not hidden anything away from Allah. So he was included in the address despite not being from amongst the malaika. So anyway, you'll come to see that now all in a moment. Alright, now we're moving on to another very important point, which is, and we have spoken on this point in the past, but any case, the point of who exactly is Iblis? Was he a jinn? Was he an angel, as the kuffar term it, a fallen angel? Is he a fallen angel? Is he a different creation all on his own called a jinn? Or rather, what is a jinn? And all these sort of things here. To put it in, sum up the whole issue, Iblis is a jinn. Jinn is a creation all of its own. He was not an angel, despite the fact that you will see now a slight difference of opinion. But in any case, he mentioned, Imam Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, he now gives forth the various viewpoints. He says, قال طاووس عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما, Imam Tawus, who is the student of Hadrat Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma, he reports that Hadrat Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma had said, كان إبليس قبل أن يركب المعصية من الملائكة اسمه عزازيل. Hadrat Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma, he said that Iblis, before he had perpetrated this sin of refusing to obey Allah, he was from the angels and his name was Azazil. Now again, like I said, this is just a difference of opinion, but the actual viewpoint is that he was not an angel. He's not a fallen angel. He was and always, right from the beginning, was a jinn and not an angel. In any case, his name was Azazil. And this is something that someone had asked a question on my blog a very long time ago. So the name of the fatwa was, what was Iblis's name before disobedience or something of that sort? And in there, what I mentioned is that the name Azazil, which is from the Hebrew in origin, it means the one who is strengthened or one who is honored by Allah, one of the two. I forget now exactly which one it is, but in any case, that is what the name Azazil means. And although he don't mean explain here what the word name Iblis means, but Iblis comes from the word Ablasa min rahmatillah, someone who has lost hope in the mercy of Allah. So that is where the name Iblis comes from. Iblis is not a, as you can say, he was born and given a name Iblis, not that sort of thing. So his name was Azazil, but when he rebelled and he refused to obey Allah, and he was now cursed and kicked out of Jannah, and he knew now his ticket to Jahannam was booked, then Ablasa min rahmatillah, he lost hope in the mercy of Allah, meaning that he's now so evil, he will never be able to come right again. So he lost hope of ever attaining the mercy of Allah. And for that reason, he got the name Iblis. So in any case, coming back to the book, he says that Hadrat Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma had said that Iblis's name used to be Azazil, and he was from the Malaika before he had taken, or rather perpetrated, this particular sin. وَكَانَ مِنْ سُكَّانِ الْأَرْضِ, and he used to be from the inhabitants of the earth. He used to live on earth. وَكَانَ مِنْ أَشَدِّ الْمَلَائِكَةِ اِجْتِهَادًا وَأَكْثَرِهِمْ عِلْمًا فَذَلِكَ دَعَاهُ إِلَى الْكِبْرِ. And according to Hazrat Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he said that وَكَانَ مِنْ أَشَدِّ الْمَلَائِكَةِ اِجْتِهَادًا, he was from the Malaika who had done the most work. اجْتِهَادًا, yeah, you can, it's not from the perspective of ilm, as you can say, being a mujtahid, but rather he was hard working. وَأَكْثَرِهِمْ عِلْمًا, this one would give you now the point of knowledge, and he had the most knowledge of all the malaika. فَذَلِكَ دَعَاهُ إِلَى الْكِبْرِ, and this is what caused him to become arrogant, because he felt himself to be the most knowledgeable and all things of that sort. وَكَانَ مِنْ حَيٍّ يُسَمَّوْنَ جِنًّا, and he was from a tribe of angels now who were known as jinn. So this year is the viewpoint of Hadrat Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma, but it is not the accepted viewpoint. The accepted viewpoint is that he was not a fallen angel, but rather he was a jinn created from fire, while malaika are a different creation created from light. So not the same type of thing. Okay, a quick off-topic question. The person had asked that what is the difference between Malaika and Jinn? What are these creations created from? That it was now, as I just mentioned, that the Malaika, they are created from Noor, which is light. While Jinn, again, on the other hand, they are Nar, they are created from fire. So that's the difference between the two. Jinn is from Nar and Malaika are from Noor. Alright, so anyway, this is now, as you can say, one viewpoint, if you sum it up, that Iblis, this is the, generally how the, you can say, the Christian viewpoint is, that Iblis, however, whichever name they call him, Lucifer and everything, he was an angel, and then he disobeyed God, or whatever, and then he became a fallen angel, and all things of that sort. So it's a similar viewpoint to this one here, that he was an angel with the name Azazil, he disobeyed Allah, and then he got given now the name Iblis, and he was from a tribe of angels called Jinn. But in any case, this is not the correct opinion, as you will see now in a moment. But in any case, this is just one of the opinions which have been mentioned. Now, the next opinion he mentions, he goes further, he says, وقال سعيد بن المسيب كان إبليس رئيس ملائكة سماء الدنيا. He mentions that Imam Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib rahimahullah, he mentions now, كان إبليس رئيس ملائكة سماء الدنيا, that Iblis was the head of the malaika of the sama al-dunya. So here's a second opinion also mentioning that Iblis was an angel. He was the head. As we know that there are various samawat, the seventh heaven, sixth heaven, and so on and so forth, and the sama'ud dunya is the lowest heaven. So according to Imam Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, he say that Iblis was the head of, he was in charge of the malaika of the sama'ud dunya. In fact, if you want to understand the sama'ud dunya, if you look up into the sky and you see all the stars and everything, that is the sama'ud dunya. So all the malaika which are contained at that particular place, Iblis was now the head, he was in charge of all of them. This is now the viewpoint of Imam Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib. That's now a second viewpoint. Now we move on to the actual viewpoint. He says, وقال ابن جرير عن الحسن. Imam ibn Jarir رحمه الله, he reports from Imam Hassan, who said that ما كان إبليس من الملائكة طرفة عين قط وإنه لأصل الجن. He says that Imam Hassan رحمه الله, he says that ما كان إبليس من الملائكة طرفة عين قط, that Iblis was never from the ملائكة, not for a blink of an eye, meaning he was ما كان إبليس من الملائكة, he was never from the ملائكة, not for a blink of an eye. It wasn't as though he was a malak and then he became a jinn and stuff all of that sort. Never. He was never an angel, he was always a jinn, right from the word go. وَإِنَّهُ But Iblis, it's now again, لَأَصْلُ الْجِنِ, his asl, his origin, he was from the jinn, he was not from the malaika. كَمَا, he says here now, كَمَا أَنَّ آدَمَ أَصْلُ الْإِنْسِ, or rather, وَإِنَّهُ لَأَصْلُ الْجِنِ, he is the origin of all jinn. Like how Adam alayhi salam is the origin of all of man. So Adam alayhi salam is the father of mankind and Iblis is the father of all jinn kind. And this in fact is another point of difference of opinion as to whether they were jinn prior to Iblis or not. And this is something that we spoke on also last time, that who inhabited the earth before mankind. And you know the various viewpoints, the bin and then the jinn and everything of the sort. So all those viewpoints which were mentioned back then. So the one viewpoint said that the jinn had inhabited the earth. So that would make it that Iblis here was not the father of the jinn. He would then be the father of the jinn in the sense that he was the last of the jinn and all the other jinn were wiped out. Other viewpoints would say no, he was created all on his own, separate, and from him came all the other jinn. Various difference of different viewpoints, but whatever the case may be, as you can say, there's nothing explicit from the Quran or Sunnah to say that Iblis was the father and from him all the jinn were created, or that says that jinn inhabited the earth before mankind. Nothing of the sort. So it's all just various opinions, and nothing is 100% proven. Any case, وَهَذَا إِسْنَادٌ صَحِيحٌ عَنِ الْحَسَنِ, that he mentions the same, this narration we were speaking about now, that the Iblis was never an angel, he was always a jinn, like, and he was the father of the jinn, like how Adam alayhi salam was father of mankind, and this sanad is authentically reported from Imam al-Hasan. Now we move on to another viewpoint. He says, وقال شهر بن حوشب كان إبليس من الجن الذين طردتهم الملائكة فأسره بعض الملائكة فذهب به إلى السماء. رواه ابن جرير. Imam Shahr ibn حوشب, he said that Iblis, he was from the jinn. Which jinn? الَّذِينَ طَرَدَتْهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ Those jinn who were expelled and driven out by the malaika. فَأَسَرَهُ بَعْضُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ Then some of the malaika, or rather one of the malaika, he imprisoned Iblis, he took him as a prisoner. فَذَهَبَ بِهِ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ And he took him up to the heavens, and that is how Iblis wound up being in Jannah. Now this comes back to the view, to that lesson which we had done some time back again on who inhabited the earth before mankind. Like I say, we mentioned the various viewpoints that the angels came to wipe out all the jinn who were disobedient on earth, and all of them were expelled and driven out and killed and things, and a small baby was left behind and he was taken up to Jannah. That was the one viewpoint. Another viewpoint said that Iblis was sent, being now from the good people still at the time, he was sent to fight against the other jinn and he wiped them out and then he went up to Jannah. So various different viewpoints. Any case, we're just now dealing with the one of Imam Shahr ibn Hawshab. He said that Iblis was from the jinn, those jinn who were driven out by the malaika, and one of the malaika had imprisoned him and taken him up to the sama, to the heavens, and that is how he ended up being there. This narration is reported by Imam Ibn Jarir rahimahullah. He moves on further, another viewpoint. He says, وَعَنْ سَعَدِ ibn Mas'ud, he said, قال كانت الملائكة تقاتل الجن فسبي إبليس وكان صغيرا فكان مع الملائكة يتعبد معها فلما أمروا بالسجود لآدم سجدوا فأبى إبليس فذلك قال تعالى إلا إبليس كان من الجن. Imam Sa'ad ibn Mas'ud, he said that the malaika had fought the jinn. Let's come back to the same viewpoint again, that the malaika was sent down against the jinn who were inhabiting the earth, and the malaika wiped out the jinn. تُقَاتِلُ الْجِنْ فَسُّبِيَ إِبْلِيسُ وَكَانَ صَغِيرًا And this is where the viewpoint comes from, that Iblis was a baby, he was a child, he was small, so the malaika didn't kill him, but they took him as a prisoner and took him up with them to Jannah. فَكَانَ مَعَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ So he was with the malaika in Jannah, يَتَعَبَّدُ مَعَهَا He used to worship Allah along with them. فَلَمَّا أُمِرُوا بِالسُّجُودِ But now, Iblis had grown up and everything of the sort, and when the Malaika were commanded to make sajda to Adam alayhi salam, سَجَدُوا فَأَبَى Iblis. All the Malaika, they made sajda, but فَأَبَى Iblis, Iblis, he refused. فَلِذَلِكَ قَالَ تَعَالَى And that is why Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the ayah, إِلَّا Iblis. All the Malaika made sajda, except Iblis. Why? كان من الجن. He was not from the Malaika, he was from the jinn. قال وقال أبو جعفر وكان من الكافرين يعني من العاصين. Imam Abu Ja'far, he mentions on the ayah وكان من الكافرين and Iblis, he was from the kafirin, from the kufar. He says يعني من العاصين, he was one of the disobedient ones. He moves further, he says قال قتادة في قوله تعالى وإذ قلنا للملائكة اسجدوا لآدم فكانت الطاعة لله والسجدة لآدم. This now deals with a different viewpoint, or rather I should say a slightly different topic now. He says that Imam Qatada now, he says, commenting on the ayah, that when we told the malaika make sajda to Adam, he said that فكانت الطاعة لله وسجدة لآدم, that the worship and the obedience was for Allah, but the sajda was to Adam alayhi salam. أكرم الله آدم أن أسجد له ملائكته, that Allah had honored, أكرم الله آدم, Allah had honored Adam alayhi salam, that he had made his malaika make sajda to him. وقال بعض الناس كان هذا سجود تحية وسلام وإكرام كما قال تعالى ورفع أبويه على العرش وخروا له سجدا. He says that some of the people have said, and they commented, and they said that this sajda of the malaika to Adam alayhi salam, this was what is known as sujood al-tahiyya wa salam wa ikram. It is a sajda of tahiyya and salam. It is greeting, peace and honor. Like how Allah Ta'ala mentions in, which is in Surah Yusuf, وَرَفَعَ أَبَوَيْهِ عَلَى الْعَرْشِ, that, and this is from the Surah Yusuf, when Yusuf alayhi salam has grown up now in Egypt and everything, and the whole incident with his brothers have passed by, and they finally learn that he is Yusuf alayhi salam after they come to him, to come in the time of the famine, and he lets them know that now that he is Yusuf alayhi salam, and he sent back his kurta for his father Yaqub alayhi salam to place on his eyes for his eyesight to come back. And when the whole family comes now to meet Yusuf alayhi salam, he وَرَفَعَ أَبَوَهِ عَلَى الْعَرْشِ, Yusuf alayhi salam was on the arsh, and he raised his parents, his father and mother, up onto the arsh with him. And وَخَرُّ لَهُ سُجَّدَ, his whole family made sajda to him. So he says it is this. He said, وَقَدْ كَانَ هَذَا مَشْرُوعًا فِي الْأُمَّمِ الْمَاضِيَةِ وَلَكِنَّهُ نُسِخَ فِي مِلَّتِنَا. He says that this used to be permissible in the previous nations, meaning for the previous sharia's. It used to be permissible to make sajda to a person, but it was made mansukh, it was abrogated in our millah, in our sharia. It is not permissible to make sajda to a person. Now, the point that he's mentioning over here is that this was sujood al-tahiyya wa salam wa ikram. It is what, basically, as you can say, it is a sajda of ikram and not a sajda of ibadah. That the malaika were not commanded worship Adam alayhi salam as a partner. That was not the case. The malaika were commanded make sajda to Adam alayhi salam as a means of honor and not as a means of worship. That's the reason why he's bringing this point over here. Now, to further this point, he quotes a hadith now that from Hazrat Mu'adh radiyallahu anhu. He says, "Qala Mu'adh, قَدِمْتُ الشَّامَ فَرَأَيْتُهُمْ يَسْجُرُونَ لِأَسَاقِفَتِهِمْ وَعُلَمَائِهِمْ فَأَنْتَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ أَحَقُّ أَنْ يُسْجَدَ لَكَ." This is now Hadrat Mu'adh radiyallahu anhu in a bit of a lengthy hadith. He said, he's narrating this to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Actually, what happened prior to this is that he came back from a journey, and he came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he made sajda to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam had asked him that, "Ma hadha, what is this that you are doing?" Then he related the story and he said, "Qadim to Sham, I went to Sham, faraituhum yasjuduna li asaqifatihim, and I found the people making sajda to their bishops wa ulama'ihim, and their scholars," meaning their rabbis and all these people, the Christians were making sajda to them. "فَأَنْتَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَحَقُّ أَنْ يُسْجَدَ لَكَ." But you, O Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you are more rightful and deserving of having someone make sajda to you. So this is why he had made sajda to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So here Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam responded to him and said, فَقَالَ لَا لَوْ كُنْتُ آمِرًا بَشِرًا أَنْ يَسْجُدَ لِبَشَرٍ لَأَمَرْتُ الْمَرْأَةَ أَنْ تَسْجُدَ لِزَوْجِهَا مِنْ عِظَامِ حَقِّهِ عَلَيْهَا. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam told him, "You should not do this," meaning a human must not make sajda to another human being. لَوْ كُنْتُ آمِرًا بَشَرًا أَنْ يَسْجُدَ لِبَشَرٍ, that if I were to command a human being to make sajda to another human being, لَأَمَرْتُ الْمَرْأَةَ أَنْ تَسْجُدَ لِزَوْجِهَا, I would command a woman to make sajda to her husband, مِنْ عِظَامِ حَقِّهِ عَلَيْهَا, due to the great enormous right he has over her. And وَرَجَّحَهُ الرَّازِي, and this viewpoint here was made the rajih, the predominant, the accept the correct viewpoint that the sajda was a sajda of tahiyya and ikram and not a sajda of ibadah. This is what Imam Ar-Razi rahimahullah has mentioned, and this is the correct viewpoint in any case. He goes further, he says, وَقَالَ بَعْضُهُمْ بَلْ كَانَتِ السَّجْدَةُ لِلَّهِ وَآدَمُ قِبْلَهِ. He says some ulama, they mentioned that the malaika were actually making sajda to Adam alayhi salam, I mean to Allah, but Adam alayhi salam was just the qibla. Like today, like how we have today, we make sajda towards the Kaaba, but we are actually making sajda to Allah. The Kaaba is just the qibla. We are not worshipping the Kaaba, we are worshipping Allah. So this is a viewpoint of some ulama. But he says, وَالْأَظْهَرُ أَنَّ الْقَوْلَ الْأَوَّلَ أَوْلَى. He says that what is most apparent is that the first viewpoint is the more correct viewpoint, that it was a sajda of tahiyya and ikram and not one of ta'a, nor was it one that Adam alayhi salam was just a qibla. He says, وَالسَّجْدَةَ لِآدَمْ كَانَتْ إِكْرَامًا وَإِعْظَامًا وَإِحْتِرَامًا وَسَلَامًا. That the sajda was for Adam alayhi salam, it was كَانَتْ إِكْرَامًا, it was honor, وَإِعْظَامًا, and okay, basically all four of these words, إِعْظَام, إِحْتِرَام, it means all honor and giving glory and nobleness to him, وَسَلَامًا, and as a means of peace and a greeting as well. وهي طاعة لله عز وجل لأنها امتثال لأمره تعالى. And this sajda of the malaika to Adam عليه السلام, this was in fact طاعة لله, it was worship for Allah. Why? لأنها امتثال لأمره تعالى, this was fulfilling the command of Allah, that Allah had given the command, make sajda. So them making sajda to Adam عليه السلام, it was actually them obeying Allah and worshipping Allah by making sajda to Adam alayhi salam. وَقَدْ قَوَّاهُ الرَّازِيُّ فِي تَفْسِيرِهِ وَضَعَفَ مَا عَدَاهُ مِنَ الْقَوْلَيْنِ الْآخَرَيْنِ. And Imam al-Razi, he has given, he has strengthened this viewpoint in his tafsir and weakened all the other viewpoints which have been mentioned, or rather the other two viewpoints which have been mentioned, he has proven it to be weak. And those two viewpoints are, كونه, the fact that, or rather I should say the viewpoint, جعل قبلة إذ لا يظهر فيه شرف. The first viewpoint, that Adam عليه السلام was made as a qibla, but the sajda was actually for Allah. He says, إذ لا يظهر فيه شرف. Because if he was just simply a qibla, then it does not give him any nobleness and virtue. والآخر أن المراد بالسجود الخضوع للإنحناء ووضع الجبهة على الأرض وهو ضعيف كما قال. The second of the viewpoints which is weak that Imam al-Razi has dispelled is the viewpoint where some people have mentioned that when Allah said أسجدوا لآدم and Allah told the Malaika make sajda to Adam, some people had mentioned that what was intended is that khudu, they must be humble, لا الانحناء ووضع الجبهات على الأرض, not that they should bow down and place their forehead on the ground. So, but he says, وهو ضعيف كما قال, but this viewpoint is weak, just like Imam al-Razi rahimahullah has mentioned. The correct viewpoint is that they had actually made sajda, placing their foreheads on the floor in a correct manner, but they were doing it as a sajda of ikram and not a sajda of ibadah. Now we go on a little bit further. He says, وَقَالَ قَتَادَ فِي قَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ أَبَى وَاسْتَكْبَرَ وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ. Imam Qatada rahimahullah, he says, commenting on the ayah, فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسِ, all the malaika, they made sajda except Iblis. أَبَى وَاسْتَكْبَرَ, he refused and he was arrogant. وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ, and he was from the kuffar. He says, حَسَدَ عَدُوَ اللَّهِ إِبْلِيسُ آدَمَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامُ عَلَى مَا أَعْطَاهُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْكَرَامَةِ وَقَالَ أَنَا نَارِيٌ وَهَذَا طِينِيٌ وَكَانَ بَدْ. Okay, I'll stop at that point. He says, Imam Qatada rahimahullah, commenting on this ayah, he said, حَسَدَ عَدُوُ اللَّهِ إِبْلِيسُ آدَمَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ, that Iblis, the enemy of Allah, he had enmity for Adam عليه السلام, عَلَى مَا أَعْطَاهُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْكَرَامَةِ, due to the honor which Allah had given to Adam عليه السلام, Iblis became jealous because he was not given this honor and things, and anyone was told, make sajda to Iblis. Nothing of that happened. So when Adam alayhi salam, a new creation suddenly created, given a higher ranking than Iblis, given more knowledge than Iblis, the names of everything and all these sorts of things, it just got a little bit too much for Iblis to handle. So the hatred and enmity welled up in him and he said, أَنَا نَارِيٌ وَهَذَا طِينِيٌ, that I am made of fire, this man is made of sand, of clay. That, you know, fire is more noble and more as you can say, more honorable than clay. So ye should be actually making sajda to me, not the other way around. This is what Iblis was getting at. And on this point here itself, the ulama have mentioned that when Iblis had made the statement, Allah did not get into a debate with Iblis, that giving him logical reasons or anything of the sort, that you have fire. If you take clay and you throw it on fire, the fire is extinguished. Allah did not give him any, as you can say, engage in any discussion with him on this point, that no, make sajda because, you know, if you throw clay on fire, the fire will go out, anything of the sort. Nothing of that sort. Straight away, Allah kicked him out of Jannah. فَخْرُجْ مِنْهَا فَإِنَّكَ رَجِيمٌ. Get out from here, for you are cursed. So, there was no, as you can say, engaging in any discussion and debate with Iblis on the topic. You are a person, as Iblis, who have no knowledge, and Allah is the most knowledgeable. So you cannot challenge Allah and show your arrogance here, thinking that I am made of fire, he is made of sand. Like, who are you to tell me to make sajda to him? You should be telling him he must make sajda to me. This was the arrogance of Iblis. Any case, he says, وَكَانَ بَدْءُ الذُّنُوبِ الْكِبْرِ. He says that the start of all sin was that of pride. That before this, there was no sin. Basically, you can say, in Jannah, there was no sin. The first sin to be committed in Jannah was this of kibr. And in fact, if you were to say with certainty, the very first sin was that of kibr. Putting aside all these various viewpoints of the various ulama who mentioned that the jinn had lived on earth and they had fought and everything of the sort, and the malaika came to wipe them out and stuff, all of that nature, that's all just viewpoints, like I say. That's nothing which is 100% certain that this or this did definitely take place, because it's not mentioned in the Quran or in the Sunnah. So in any case, what is 100% certain and authenticated is this incident here with Iblis and his kibr. So therefore, with certainty, the very first sin to have been perpetrated was that of kibr. Istakbara aduwallahi ay yasjuda li Adam alayhi salam. That the enemy of Allah, Iblis, he was too proud to make sajda to Adam alayhi salam. قلت وقد ثبت في الصحيح لا يدخل الجنة من كان في قلبه مثقال حبة من خردل من كبر. Okay, this is now coming back to the point over here. He says that Imam Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, now himself is speaking when he says قلت. He said وقد ثبت في الصحيح, and it has been established in the sahih, an authentic hadith, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that لا يدخل الجنة من كان في قلبه مثقال حبة من خردل من كبر. That no person shall enter Jannah in whose heart there is a mustard seed worth of arrogance and pride. وقد كان في قلب إبليس, while in the heart of Iblis, من الكبر والكفر والعناد ما ابتضى طرده وإبعاده عن جناب الرحمة وحضرة القدس. He says, while in the heart of Iblis, there was arrogance, there was kufr, there was rejection, there was opposition. To such a degree, ما اقتضى طرده وإبعاده, it was enough to have him expelled and to have him sent far away from the mercy of Allah and from the حضرات القدس, from the noble prayer, being near to Allah. He was pushed far away and expelled due to the amount of pride, kufr, and rejection and disobedience and evil that he had inside of him. قال بعض المعربين وكان من الكافرين أي وصار من الكافرين بسبب امتناعه كما قال فكان من المغرقين وقال فتكون من الظالمين. He says, some of the mu'aribin they mentioned, وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ, that Iblis, he was from the kafirin. He said, أي, وَصَارَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ بِسَبَبِ امْتِنَاعِهِ, that Iblis became a kafir as a result of his refusal. That, what was the kufr of Iblis? That, you know, normally we know what makes a person a kafir and things of the sort. We know what are the nullifiers of Iman, basically. So what was the nullifier of Iman which Iblis was guilty of? It was this, his refusal to obey Allah, that when Allah had commanded him, he was arrogant and he refused to obey. So that was Kufr Akbar, which made him a kafir and put him where he is today, that he will be fi nari jahannam khalidina fiha abada. Which, if we look in our own, in regards to our own self, how much of this don't we do on a daily basis ourselves? And yet Allah forgives us and gives us chances, that Allah does not put us in the same category. That, imagine if it was a case that where you are commanded and you don't fulfill the command, it would put you outside the fold of Islam. Then on a daily basis, every person who sins would become a kafir. But Allah has mercy upon us, and Allah regards a sin to be a sin as long as you don't make the sin halal and things all of that nature. So as long as you commit a sin and you ask forgiveness, Allah will still forgive you and everything of that sort. Any case, he says, كَمَا قَالَ فَكَانَ مِنَ الْمُغْرَقِينَ. Okay, he's now, وَقَالَ فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. He's now speaking from an Arabic perspective. He says, وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ. That's when Allah said, وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ, meaning he became a kafir as a result of this action. Like how it's mentioned, فَكَانَ مِنَ الْمُغْرَقِينَ, with regards to the son of Nuh alayhi salam in the floods, when he refused to get in the boat with Nuh alayhi salam, and he said, I'm going to climb the high mountain and everything of the sort. وَحَالَ بَيْنَهُمَ الْمَوْجُ فَكَانَ مِنَ الْمُغْرَقِينَ. Then the wave separated the two of them, meaning Nuh alayhi salam in the ark and the son who was climbing on the mountain. فَكَانَ مِنَ الْمُغْرَقِينَ. And then وَصَارَ مِنَ الْمُغْرَقِينَ. Basically, he became amongst the drowned people. He was drowned, in other words. So he was drowned, meaning فَكَانَ مِنَ الْمُغْرَقِينَ. If you were to understand what he's trying to say here, is كَانَ is past tense. So وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ, he was of the kafirin. فَكَانَ مِنَ الْمُغْرَقِينَ, he was of the drowned ones. That is basically why he is giving this meaning here. Meaning وَصَارَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ وَصَارَ مِنَ الْمُغْرَقِينَ, he became from the kuffar, he became from the drowned people as a result of this particular action. That's why he's bringing this point over here. Okay, and also فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. This year, فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ is again in reference to Adam alayhi salam and Hawa alayhi salam, that eating from the tree and everything. فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ, it's the same kana, just in the dual form now. فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ, that they became from the ظالمين as a result of that. Anyway, or rather I should say, فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ, then you will become from the ظالمين if you do this. Because this was now, فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ was the warning which Allah had given to Adam alayhi salam, that وَلَا تَقْرَبَ هَذِي الشَّجَرَةَ فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ, do not come near to this tree, meaning and eat of it, because if you do, فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ, then you too will be, both of you and Hawa alayhi salam together, تَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ, you too will become from the ظَالِمِينَ, the wrongdoers. So it's not that if you come near to the street, then you all, both of you were already transgressors. That's not what is being meant. So anyway, like I say, it's just from an Arabic perspective, that although the word kana is used, but it's used for future tense that when you do this action, then this is the going to be the result. He says, وقال الشاعر, he quotes now some poem. He say, بتيهاء قفر ومطي ومطي بتيهاء قفر والمطي كأنها قتل حزن قد كانت فراخا بيوضها. Alright, so anyway, that poem is a bit of the, as you can say, the high level poetry. So I'm going to skip that one and move on to continue onwards from page 54. He says, أي قد صارت. Basically, in a nutshell, all the poem and everything that he's quoting over here is just to show that kana comes in the meaning of sara, that which, if you were to generally translate it, kana is past tense, was, and sara is, so to say, future tense, becoming. So, قد صارت, he became. وقال ابن فورك تقديره وقد كان في علم الله من الكافرين ورجحه القرطبي. That was now the one viewpoint which was just mentioned now, that وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ أي وَصَارَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ, that when it said that Iblis in this ayah here, that وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ, and Iblis became a kafir as a result of this action, that was one viewpoint. The second viewpoint was, which is mentioned here by Imam Ibn Fawrak, he says the taqdeer, meaning the hidden, the or rather the removed words which are actually, or rather which comes in the person's mind, which is actually being said, is وَقَدْ كَانَ فِي عِلْمِ اللَّهِ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ. So وَقَدْ فِي عِلْمِ اللَّهِ, those are the words which are not mentioned there, but it's like how we speak and we leave many words out, but we understand from the speech what a person is trying to say, despite you know, the fact that you are not using those particular words. So that is basically what is being done here. So وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ, what it means is, and in the knowledge of Allah, Iblis was always going to be a kafir. Or in the knowledge of Allah, he always was a kafir, whichever way you want to take it. So that's now the second viewpoint. So one says he became a kafir as a result, and the second one says he was always a kafir. As far in the knowledge of Allah, he was always a kafir. And this viewpoint, that you, the second viewpoint, this is said by Imam Qurtubi, rahimahullah, to be the rajih view. Okay, here now he moves on to another point, separate from this. He says, فقال قال علماؤنا من أظهر الله على يديه ممن ليس بنبي كرامات وخوارق وخوارق للعادات فليس ذلك دالا على ولايته خلافا لبعض الصوفية والرافضة. He says وذكر هنا مسألة, that he mentions over here a mas'ala. He says, قَالَ عُلَمَاؤُنَا, our ulama say, that مَنْ أَظْهَرَ اللَّهُ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ, that a person upon whom upon whose hands Allah brings forth a karama, a, so to say, a miracle. خَوَارِقٌ لِلْعَادَى, something which is contrary to the norm. Basically, I'll explain that in a moment. He says, such a person who is not a Nabi, فَلَيْسَ ذَلِكَ دَالًا عَلَى وِلَايَتِهِ, then this action is not proof upon this person being a Wali. Contrary to some of the Sufis and the Rawafid, the Shia, who say that if you do a miracle, you must be a saint. Any case, now, what was خَوَارِقَ لِلْعَادَاتِ that you spoke of here, contrary to the norm? For example, you put your hand in fire, you will burn. Now you put your hand in fire and you don't burn. This is what is termed as something which is خارقٌ للعادة, something which is contrary to the norm. You cut with the knife and you bleed, but you cut with the knife and you don't bleed. خارقٌ للعادة. For example, with Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he tried to slaughter Ismail alayhi salam, the knife was super sharp, but when he cut, Allah prevented the blade from cutting. This was something which is termed خارقٌ للعادة. It goes against the normal way. The fire which burns, when Ibrahim alayhi salam was thrown into the fire did not burn. Allah removed that quality of burning from the fire. So he was in the fire and the fire was cool and it was not burning him. So this is what is termed as something which is khariqun lil'ada. So in any case, he says that if a person does, basically you see somebody is doing some miracle, as he, let's call it just simply so it's easy to understand. You see a person doing a miracle, then him doing this miracle is not proof that he is a saint, in other words. Now Imam Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, he goes further and he comments, he says, قُلْتُ وَقَدْ إِسْتَدَلَّ بَعْضُهُمْ عَلَى أَنَّ الْخَارِقَ قَدْ يَكُونُ عَلَى يَدَيْ غَيْرِ الْوَلِيِّ بَلْ قَدْ يَكُونُ عَلَى يَدِ الْفَاجِرِ وَالْكَافِرِ أَيْضًا بِمَا ثَبَتَ عَنْ إِبْنِ الصَّيَّادِ أَنَّهُ قَالَ هُوَ الدُّخُّ حِينَ خَبَّأَ لَهُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. He says, Imam Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, he says that وَقَدْ إِسْتَدَلَّ بَعْضُهُمْ, that some of the ulama, they have used as dalil the fact that something which is contrary to the norm, it can قَدْ يَكُونُ عَلَى يَدَيْ غَيْرِ الْوَلِي, it can come from a person who is not a wali. بَلْ قَدْ يَكُونُ عَلَى يَدِ الْفَاجِرِ وَالْكَافِرِ, it can even come from a fajir, an open transgressing sinner, وَالْكَافِرِ أَيْضًا, even from a kafir too. So you get miracles from kuffar, from fasiqeen, from the fujar, and everything of the sort. Now when we talk about miracles, then what exactly is being meant over here? One thing is something which comes from the side of Allah, and then there is things which comes from the side of magic, shaitan, and things of that nature. So when it comes to a kafir and a fajr, a fasiq, the fujar, you see a person doing magic and things of this here. If you look at magic, you can say a man makes magic and he walks on water, and a wali through a karama, Allah lets him walk on water. Like the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they rode with their horses over the water even. That was a karama. So if you were to look at it, apparently it seemed the same. So the fact that the person is, a miracle is emerging from a person, is not a sign that the person is a saint, which is generally the concept. A person feel, if this person is doing a miracle, he must be a saint. It's not necessary. In fact, Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah had mentioned it, if I'm not mistaken, in Majmu' al-Fatawa, that if you see a person walking on water or flying in the sky and things like this here, this is not a proof that the person is a pious person, is a wali, he is close to Allah. The person may be working with shayateen and doing sihr and things of that sort too. So that is not what is piety. You don't measure a person's piety by the amount of cheap tricks that he can do. That's basically what is being said in a nutshell. So anyway, coming back to where it is here, he said that these things which are the khariqun lil'ada, something which is contrary to the norm, it can come from a fajr, it can come from a kafir also, like how it's established from Ibn Sayyad. Now Ibn Sayyad, he was a Jewish child in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and there's a lot of ikhtilaf with regards to Ibn Sayyad. Hadrat Umar radiallahu anhu had believed Ibn Sayyad to be Dajjal, because Ibn Sayyad was a very strange character. He used to lay in his sleep and mumble things, and he knew things, so to say, of the unseen to a degree. For example, he's, like how Imam Ibn Kathir rahimahullah mentions over here, he says, أَنَّهُ قَالَ هُوَ الدُّخُ. Dukh means smoke. حِينَ خَبَّأَ لَهُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ فَارْتَقِبْ يَوْمَ تَأْتِ السَّمَاءُ بِدُخَانٍ مُبِينٍ. He says that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم once tried to test Ibn Sayyad, because again, the issue with Ibn Sayyad was very difficult. That in fact, that Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu once asked permission to kill Ibn Sayyad. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prevented him and said that if he is Dajjal, then you will not be able to kill him. And if he is not Dajjal, then you would have killed an innocent person. So confusing was the case of Ibn Sayyad. So On one occasion when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam tried to test Ibn Sayyad, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam hid asked him that, what am I thinking about? So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not tell him, but Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam was thinking of the ayah, فَارْتَقِبْ يَوْمَ تَأْتِ السَّمَاءُ بِدُخَانٍ مُبِينٍ. This word دُخَانٍ مُبِينٍ, a clear smoke. So Ibn Sayyad, he thought and then he said, وَدُخْ, it is a smoke. So it is as though he read the mind of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, not fully because he could not repeat the ayah, but basically got the gist that you're thinking something about smoke. So this is just one of the things which came from Ibn Sayyad. There were many others as well. He says, وَبِمَا كَانَ يَسْتُرَ عَنْهُ أَنَّهُ كَانَ يَمْلَأُ الطَّرِيقَ إِذَا غَضِبَ حَتَّى ضَرَبَهُ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ بْنِ عُمَرَ وَمِمَا ثَبَتَتْ بِهِ الْأَحَادِيثُ الدَّجَّالِ بِمَا يَكُونُ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ مِنَ الْخَوَارِقِ الْكَثِيرَةِ مِنْ أَنَّهُ يَأْمُرُ السَّمَاءَ أَنْ تُمْطِرَ فَتُمْطِرُ وَالْأَرْضَ أَنْ تُنْبِتَ فَتُنْبِتُ. Okay, وتتبعه كنوز الأرض مثل اليعاسب وأنه يقتل ذلك الشاب. Okay, let me just finish this part. ثم يحييه إلى غير ذلك من الأمور المهولة. مهولة. من الأمور المهولة. He says that the case of Ibn Sayyad was so confusing that many of the ahadith and the signs which have been mentioned regarding Dajjal, it could be found in Ibn Sayyad. That is why the Sahaba radiallahu anhum were confused like this. Like I mentioned, Umar radiallahu anhu believed for the certainty that Ibn Sayyad was indeed Dajjal. So, as you can say, clear were the signs of Dajjal in him that Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu had thought this. He says, وَبِمَا كَانَ يَسْتُرُ عَنُهُ. He's continuing further, he says, and all the other things which came from him. أَنَّهُ كَانَ يَمْلَأُ الطَّرِيقَ إِذَا غَضِبَ. That he used to fill up the road when he became angry. حَتَّى ضَرَبَهُ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ بْنِ عُمَرَ. Until Hazrat Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu had hit him. Basically that when he became angry, he became bigger, he grew. He filled the road up. So large he became. And he says, وَبِمَا ثَبَتَتْ بِهِ الْأَحَادِيثُ الدَّجَّالِ. All the other authentic ahadith of Dajjal which were found in him, which you used to be able to be found on his hands, which are all خَوَارِقٌ لِلْأَعَادَ, all these things which are contrary to the norm, and he said many of them were to be found. مِنْ أَنَّهُ يَأْمُرُ السَّمَاءَ أَنْ تُمْطِرَ فَتُمْطِرَ. That if Ibn Sayyad, he would tell the sky, like command the sky to rain and it would rain, and he would command the earth to bring forth its crops and it would bring it forth. So you know, these are the salient features of Dajjal and Ibn Sayyad. These things were taking place from him. So you can understand why the Sahaba radiallahu anhum had this belief that Ibn Sayyad was Dajjal. Of course, we know in the other hadith of Hadrat Tamim al-Dari radiallahu anhu, the lengthy hadith of having gone to this, washed up on this island, and he met Dajjal being chained up, everything of the sort. So anyway, but at the time, this Ibn Sayyad, where all these sort of things were taking place, that commanding the sky to rain and commanding the earth to give forth its crops, وَتَتْبَعُهُ كُنُوزُ الْأَرْضِ, and the treasures of the earth used to follow him. Like how when Dajjal comes, all the treasures of the world will basically, it will be مثل اليعاسيب, like bees, it will follow, you know, a bee, it follows, it's got, you can put a bee wherever, it will find its way back home. So in this manner, the treasures of the earth will follow Dajjal. And this is how it used to be also with Ibn Sayyad. وَأَنَّهُ يَقْتُلُ ذَلِكَ الشَّابِ ثُمَّ يُحْيِهِ. And how he will kill that youth and then bring him back to life. إِلَى غَيْرِ ذَلِكَ مِنَ الْأُمُورِ الْمُهَوَّلَةِ. And along with all the other, the very scary affairs which will take place with the coming of Dajjal. That is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informed us to such an extent of the fitna of Dajjal and the great trials and tribulations which will take place with the coming of Dajjal. So, any case, the whole point that he brought all this of Ibn Sayyad and Dajjal and things is that just because a person is doing some sort of miracle, it does not mean it is a miracle from the side of Allah. It can also be something from the side of Iblis and Dajjal and all these sort of things over here. Any case, continuing on to finish off the... Just to finish off the last point, he says, وَكَانَ اللَّيْثُ بْنُ سَعَدٍ يَقُولُ إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُ الرَّجُلَ يَمْشِي عَلَى الْمَاءِ وَيُطِيرُ فِي الْهَوَاءِ فَلَا تَغْتَرُّ بِهِ حَتَّى تَعْرِضُ أَمْرَهُ عَلَى الْكِتَابِ وَالسُّنَّةِ. This is a statement you can live by. Imam Layth ibn Sa'ad, one of the great a'immah. In fact, who is Imam Layth ibn Sa'ad? Imam Layth ibn Sa'ad, rahimahullah, was a mujtahid mutlaq in his own right. He had his own madhab, the Layth madhab. But unlike the four famous a'immah, Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Ahmad, and Imam Malik, Imam Layth ibn Sa'ad, his students had not preserved his madhab, rulings and stuff like that. So his madhab died out. Although there were many other ulama as well who had their own madhahib, but their madhahib did not, as you can say, stand the test of time. They became extinct with the followers dying out and of course not having written things down. So that is how those madhahib are not existing anymore. So this was Imam Layth ibn Sa'ad, one of those great imams of the past. Imam Layth ibn Sa'ad, rahimahullah, he had said, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُ الرَّجُلَ, when you see a person, يَمْشِي عَلَى الْمَا وَيَطِيرُ فِي الْهَوَى, you see him walking on the water and flying in the sky, فَلَا تَغْتَرُّ بِهِ, don't be misled by him, حَتَّى تَعْرِضُ أَمْرَهُ عَلَى الْكِتَابِ وَالسُنَّةِ, until you judge and you place his actions on the scale of the Quran and Sunnah. Look at this person in the light of the Quran and Sunnah. Is he a person who follows Quran and Sunnah? If so, well and good, fine, we will accept him. But now if he's a charlatan, a grave-worshipping, deviant believer in kufr and things like this, and he's flying in the sky and stuff like this and saying he's a wali of Allah, we will not take the word of such a person, no matter what sort of magic and miracles and things he can come out with. Okay, question over here. Isn't Dajjal allowed to ask for rain only once? Also, making dead alive just once by the permission of Allah, of course. As far as this mentioned, I do not know of him only asking once for it to rain. I only know the hadith mentions once in bringing the person back to life. So he will kill the person and bring him back to life, and he will not be able to kill him and bring him back to life a second time. But as for causing the rain to come and the crops to grow and things of that sort, I have not come across the hadith restricting it to only once. So he will be like, he will travel from land to land and come to land and it's drought, and he will command the sky and the rain will come, and it'll be famine and he'll command the earth and the crops will come forth with all its fruit and stuff like that. So he will do it as he travels through the earth, bringing things out like this. So it's not a once-off with those things. The only time it's a once-off is with this killing of this person. Again, because when it comes to the killing of this person, this is in fact a test that he will kill this person and bring this person back. While with the rest of the stuff, the bringing of the rains and stuff like this, this is all just from his, as you can say, his magic that he will do it in this manner to mislead the people. Wallahu a'lam. Alright, so in any case, that was then the end of ayah number 34. And inshallah, we will be ending on this point of a year, and next time we will continue onwards from ayah number 35 and 36. So if anyone has any questions with regards to the class, you can feel free to ask your questions now. Alright then, seeing as we have no further questions, we will be ending here then on this point here, inshallah. So until then, we will end for now, and we say wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad, subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk, wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.